Hello, my name's Cathy Fava, and I'm calling this talk The Living Water. And I'll be looking at that beautiful encounter of Jesus in the Bible with the woman at the well, and unpacking a bit what it means when Jesus says that he is the living water. We'll be looking at how we can come more into that meaningful life that God is offering us, the fullness of life that God promises us. Water is a powerful spiritual symbol for us. Water revives us, it refreshes us, it quenches our thirst, it cleanses and purifies us, it cools us, and it's soothing. It's peaceful, yet powerful. It has a calming sound. It's revitalizing, life-giving and invigorating. Well, God is the fountain of living water. In Jeremiah 2, the fountain that never runs dry. Jesus says in the passage I referred to, whoever drinks this water will get thirsty again, but anyone who drinks the water that I shall give will never be thirsty again. Wow, that water that completely satisfies us. And later, if anyone is thirsty, let them come to me. Let them come and drink who believe in me. The Holy Spirit is represented by water, flowing into us and giving us life. You know, when you see a neglected houseplant, how sad it is that the leaves are all wilted and drooping, aren't they? And then you give it water, put some water in the pot, and soon after, the leaves are upright and full of life again. Is God asking today, can I revive your drooping spirit? He wants to bring us his rest and his peace. Near restful waters he leads me to revive my drooping spirit, Psalm 22, verse 3. And that's the promise for us today. I love sitting by a bubbling stream and just being with God. It's such a lovely thing, I think, to do. God is the one who refreshes us, who revitalizes us, restores us and quenches our thirst. He gives us life and he cleanses us and satisfies us. So God is inviting you to soak in him, to dwell in him, and to just receive his love. So come to the living water. Slow down and connect with God. And become aware of him loving you. Just stop to notice and receive it. Becoming aware of God in the present moment. We encounter God in all things if we are aware. So I'd encourage you to awaken your senses today. Take that time to appreciate the beauty around you, the smells of the flowers and the sounds of the birds singing, and that lovely feel of the breeze on your skin. Just tuning into God. How is he with you today? How is he blessing you today? I was really blessed recently by watching a bee gathering nectar from some flowers. You know, there was the beautiful colours and the wonderful scent. But I was really touched by how everything was so perfectly positioned in that flower. So as the bee drank the nectar, it brushed against the pollen and then it went off to another flower, pollinating it without even realising it. It was the positioning of the stamen and the anthers, really loaded with pollen, that was so perfect that spoke to me. It spoke to me of God being in every detail. He really has got it all in hand. And I watched the birds as they fed happily. Look at the birds in the sky. They do not sow or reap or gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not worth much more than they are? Matthew 6, verse 26. Jesus does say, look, though, doesn't he? And we do need to stop and look and to notice and to meet God in the world around us and in our experiences. Seeing God in all things, he's loving you and caring for you and blessing you. St. Gianna wrote, the secret to happiness is to live moment by moment and to thank God for what he is sending us every day in his goodness. In the Catechism of the Catholic Church, we read, the Beatitudes respond to the natural desire for happiness. This desire is of divine origin. God has placed it in the human heart in order to draw man to the one who alone can fulfil it. Tears are water as well, aren't they? Tears of sadness and tears of joy. And we offer it all to God. So it's really good to take time to be with God in prayer and to drink in what he says to you, allowing his word to fall upon you like the spring rain, refreshing your soul and refreshing your spirit. He will pour out water on the thirsty soil, streams on the dry ground. So let's take a look at that passage from John 4, verse 5 onwards. A Samaritan woman meets Jesus at the well when she goes to collect water, and she encounters him in a life-changing way. It's one of my favourite passages in the Bible, and I love these accounts of Jesus interacting with women in the Gospels. They speak to us so powerfully, don't they, about the person of Jesus. My son was always interested in politics when he was younger. He would say how cool and awesome Jesus is from this way that he broke down barriers and related to women in a radical way. He'd challenge and overturn the views of the time regarding women, and he would affirm their value. This isn't just something that speaks to women. It speaks to men and to young people as well. I remember a story of a priest who was trying to teach young people about Jesus, and he was quite discouraged by their lack of enthusiasm. And then he told them about the account of the Pharisees with the woman caught in adultery and how the Pharisees had wanted to stone her. And they asked Jesus, "What do you say?" And the priest told the teenagers the reply of Jesus, "Let any one of you without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." Well, when he said that, silence fell in the classroom, and there was a trendy teenager at the back of the classroom who spoke up and said, "Oh, wow, that is so cool." Now, this is the awesome, cool Jesus that we want our young people to know about. He wasn't a weak person, like often is depicted in the pictures of Jesus. He stood up against the prejudices of his time for what was right, despite the opinions of others. And this account of the woman at the well is extraordinary for several reasons. What Jesus did was shocking, and you can see that in the reaction of the disciples when they come back, and they're shocked when they see Jesus speaking with this woman. Well, why is that? First of all, Jewish people didn't associate with Samaritans. There was an ongoing historical feud between the Jews and the Samaritans, and they viewed them as outcasts, and they didn't eat with them. So for Jesus to ask for her to share a cup with him, and when he asked her for a drink, that would have been considered to result in becoming unclean. Many Jews would avoid going through Samaria altogether and take a long way round to get from Judea to Galilee. But Jesus walked straight through Samaria. Also, Jewish men were not supposed to speak to women alone in public places, particularly rabbis who would not have spoken to her. But Jesus was alone with her, talking to her. And it wasn't a quick conversation either. It was one of the longest, if not the longest, recorded that Jesus is speaking to another person in the gospel. This woman is not any woman. She's come to the well at an unusual time of the day when it's very hot and she is alone. The woman would have gone together in groups to fetch water and in the early morning or at sunset. So she was a shunned woman with a bad reputation, who was an outcast from her community, and she was alone. But Jesus does it again. He puts love before his reputation, and he stands up against the negative views and the barriers of the Jewish custom. This woman is desperate, hurt, and lonely, and probably ashamed. And now, at this well, this lonely, despised woman meets Jesus, and her life is changed. Jesus reveals everything about her. He knows her and understands her. But he doesn't judge her. He gives her respect and dignity and compassion. What I love is that he takes time to be present to her. He talks with her. And over the course of this conversation, you see her changing. Jesus offers this woman, who is thirsty for life, living water. Water that when she drinks it, she'll never be thirsty again. And as she connects with Jesus, she experiences hope and joy. And she's discovering that unconditional love and that acceptance that she's been looking for, that we're all looking for. This is a transformational experience for her. She's so transformed. She leaves her water pot behind and she goes to tell everyone in the village about Jesus. And they see such a change in her. They want to come and meet Jesus for themselves because they want what she has. This woman whose life is transformed as she comes into her destiny in God. She's not a lonely, sad woman anymore. She's now an evangelist, full of zeal and joy. She's recognised by some as the first to proclaim the gospel of Christ. And I discovered quite recently, which I really like, because this makes this story more personal for me, I discovered that in the Orthodox tradition, the Samaritan woman has a name, Saint Fotini or Fotina. And that means the illuminated or enlightened one, because Jesus illuminates her heart and he invites her to leave behind her current life and to come into the new life that he has for her. And there's a beautiful Orthodox icon of this meeting of this woman with Jesus. Her putting her pot down and leaving it behind is significant. For me, it represents her leaving behind her restricted life and entering into the fullness of life that God has for her. You know, does that speak to you? Is there anything God is inviting you maybe to leave behind? That pot that the woman puts down, that could represent how we can limit our lives and end up living small, comfortable lives when God has so much more for us. And it's easy, isn't it, to fall into the temptations that the world offers, the illusions of the world, temptations of living a life for success or pleasure or money. But these things fail to satisfy us, and before long we feel empty and we're longing for something more. I think in Jeremiah 2, verse 13, this describes what I'm saying exactly. They have abandoned me, the fountain of living water, only to dig cisterns for themselves, leaky cisterns that hold no water. So I'd really encourage you to spend time in prayer with this scripture and to encounter Jesus in a personal way for you. Listen to him, speak to him. See if he's inviting you to something. Maybe you can go and tell others about what God has done for you, just like this woman did, so that they can encounter God for themselves in a personal way. God isn't disapproving of you. He cares for you and he understands. Have you ever experienced this drinking a cup of water and then before long you're dissatisfied and thirsty again? Jesus is offering you himself. He is the spring of living water. If you drink from him, you will not thirst. Our inner thirsts are only quenched by our relationship and life with Jesus. We can just easily end up somewhere, can't we? Living a life of mediocrity and comfort, lives we fit into a small pot. But where do I want to go in my life? Not just end up somewhere. God moves us out of our comfort zone and into who I really am, my authentic self. And I live a life that's deeper, more fruitful, more meaningful, more full of joy, and one that makes a difference. But do I need that courage to step out and to trust God and to yield to him? We are created for so much more. God wants us to come into the fullness of the destiny that he has for us, to become saints. I mean, it's really exciting. But how do we know what God has for us in our lives? And how can we come more into the life he intends for us to live, that fullness of life I was talking about? Well, I'm talking here about the art of discernment, the art of finding God's will. And I've already touched on some of the basic discernment keys previously in another talk, when we looked at the importance of getting in touch with what do I really want and those deeper desires and longings in my heart, because these are one and the same as God's desires and will for me. So the key discernment is noticing, listening to what's happening in my heart and my inner life, what's going on in my inner experiences, and reflecting and understanding these stirrings in my heart, rejecting what I recognise isn't from God, and accepting what's from God, and then acting on those. But this needs a sifting process. I need to sift through the felt experience of my life. and ask, which direction is this experience taking me, towards God or away from him? Where is it coming from and where is it leading me to? Attentiveness is how I become aware of God's action in my life, and I can then follow the action of God. And St. Ignatius of Loyola is a great help in this for us, giving some really practical ways of dealing with this sifting process. In our spiritual lives, we go through times when we experience spiritual consolation and spiritual desolation, feelings or stirrings which influence my life of faith and my progress towards God and seeking his will. Spiritual consolation is every increase in faith, hope, and love. This comes from God and leads us towards God and towards others in love. I have more joy. Now, sometimes this feels painful, such as if we share in the pain of another person, or we feel the sorrow for our sins. But it's a positive thing, and it leads us into more freedom in God. I experience peace, but that isn't the same as being easy or comfortable. Just look at what people say who are living radically for God. Jackie Pullinger is an inspirational woman for me. She served God in the notoriously dangerous walled city in Hong Kong, amongst the gangsters and drug addicts and prostitutes, where there are open sewers and rats and slums. But she said this: "I just feel this incredible joy. And I thought, why am I feeling like this?" And she was asked why she doesn't write more books. She's written a couple of books. And she said, "I don't go on writing books about what God has done through us. I want people to go on writing books about what God does through them. Otherwise, people are going to get all the thrills through what has happened through me, instead of all the thrills through what God wants to do through them." And she continued, "So we'd better get equipped to do it, instead of living this life as if this life is it. It's not. It's a very short life. And eternal life is forever. We're going to feel stupid for eternity if we've wasted this one." That's what the joy of spiritual consolation is like. We may not all have the grace to go into the walled city with just $10 in our pocket. The walled city isn't there anymore anyway, is it? But you do have the grace for what you are called to. St. Mother Teresa said, "Find your own Calcutta." Because God has an adventure for each of us, where we can say from our heart, "This is right where I'm meant to be." Peace comes when we're in the right place, doing the right thing. St. Ignatius said, "Few souls understand what God would accomplish in them if they were to abandon themselves unreservedly to him, and if they were to allow his grace to mould them accordingly." We don't always experience spiritual consolation, though, and at times we experience the pull of spiritual desolation, which would lead us away from God. And this is where there's a decrease of hope, faith, and love. And we experience negative feelings like hopelessness and despair and spiritual lethargy, and we're focused in on ourselves. We feel sadness to do with the things of God and progressing in our faith. God is always with us, of course, but we don't feel it. Desolation is not sent from God. It leads me off course in my spiritual life if I follow it. To follow it means I'm not following the guidance of God. So it's important to see where these feelings are leading us. If desolation is followed, it leads me away from God and love of others. "When God touches the soul, he does so sweetly, lightly, and gently," St. Ignatius says, "like a drop of water entering a sponge. The evil spirit touches the soul sharply with noise and disquiet, as when a drop of water falls on a stone." So what should we do if we experience spiritual desolation? What to do so I grow and so that it won't become detrimental for me spiritually? Well, St. Ignatius again gives us brilliant advice here. We need to act, and to act against the forces that are keeping us in desolation, to avoid going in this downward spiral. There is a way out, and I can have hope. So, Don't change a decision you made regarding your faith life when in desolation. Something that you discerned when you're in a good place and in peace and hearing clearly from God. Because, as I said, you're not being guided by God now, but in confusion. So wait for the desolation to pass and when you're in peace again, and then look at your decision. And we need to reflect and learn from our weaknesses. So how not to fall into the common traps of the enemy for us personally, recognising those traps for us. Remembering that this will pass and consolation will return. So patience is needed in times of desolation to persevere through it and to stand firm and to not give up. And remember that God is in it with us. He gives me the sufficient grace I need to cope. So I ask God to help me. I go forward in the way I know is right, and I use what's helped me before. So I can take positive action, like increasing my prayer, even though I might feel like dropping it. I can go to those scriptures that are personal for me and that helped me in the past. What has strengthened me spiritually before? Looking back at when God felt close, maybe going back to what I wrote in my journal in those times. Meditating on God's love, on the truths of God's faithful love. And that increases my hope and sustains me. Maybe listening to talks that you found helpful or reading things in spiritual books that you found helpful before. And reflect on why you might be feeling like this. Is there a cause that becomes apparent to you so you can respond wisely and effectively? And do something good, something loving for someone else. This helps you take your mind off yourself and protects you from self-pity. And St. Ignatius encourages us in desolation to extend ourselves in some suitable way of doing penance. So rather than just choosing to gratify myself or escape in through any kind of indulgences, maybe I can do the opposite and choose to do something positive, to be cheerful, to serve someone in need, despite not feeling like it. What positive thing could I do? Maybe I could bake a cake for someone or bring someone some flowers or just ring someone up who's feeling lonely. But remember, this is not a passive time. This is an active time. I would also add going out for a walk. To be outside and close to nature can really help. To engage with what gives you life, and I spoke about this in a previous talk. Maybe you love beautiful music. You know, this could be really helpful for you in these times. Some of those simple things can really help us. St. Alphonsus Liguori said, "Whenever we feel trapped in a bad mood, we should try to dispel it immediately and not linger over it, distracting ourselves by reading a book, by singing a snatch of a hymn, or by discussing some pleasant topic with a friend." Some simple practical advice there. St. Ignatius also says it's helpful for us to look at why we are suffering desolation, and he gives us three reasons. Have we been negligent in our prayer and lost our focus? Well, if that's the case, we renew our commitment and we're converted and we grow spiritually. Secondly, maybe God is allowing it to see whether we will remain faithful if we're not rewarded with consolations. And again, we learn a lot from that and we grow in maturity. Or does God allow it to enable us to become aware that this is not within our power to attain these spiritual consolations? They are God's gift to us, and through that, we grow in humility. So we can grow through desolation if we know how to resist it and respond well, as St. Ignatius guides us to. Remember, God doesn't send it, he permits it, because it can help us, but only if we respond in the right way. So if we do use the advice of St. Ignatius, and we make use of that sufficient grace we have from God in these times, we hopefully won't suffer these periods of desolation so often or for so long in the future, because we know what to do. And although it's normal to experience the fluctuations of spiritual consolation and spiritual desolation, we attain more balance in our spiritual lives, more freedom and more maturity. Spiritual consolation will come again. This is the normal state for us to be in when we are in God's will, a place of peace and of joy. So we want to take time to reflect, and we don't want to be pulled all over the place by our surface feelings, but to go deeper and to get in touch with how God is calling me through these feelings of consolation. God is in those deeper feelings. The attraction I have to those decisions where I do the more loving thing. And I need that time and space to get in touch with these deeper feelings. Is it God guiding me? And where are these feelings leading me? It's really important to talk to someone who can help you, and sharing with someone who can accompany you spiritually. And this helps you to discover for yourself how God speaks to you, how he speaks to you personally, and then you can decide what action to take. There's obviously a lot more I could say about discernment, and I don't have time here, but just remember our aim. Our aim is to get in touch with God's will for our life, which is where our happiness lies, and our fruitfulness and our fulfillment, that living water that satisfies us. Cardinal Raniero Cantalamessa says, we can actually only fail at one thing. We don't fail in our work or as a parent or whatever. We only fail if we do not become holy, because we are all called to holiness, and that is our vocation in life. To be holy is what we are made for. That is our destiny, and so it needs to be our aim. St. Mother Teresa said, holiness is a necessity, and she said it is a duty. So maybe we need to step out in faith in order to see God act in our lives. In Jeremiah we read, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. You really can come to know the unique destiny that God in his love has prepared for your life and which will make you happy. So I'd just like to finish by praying for you. Come, Holy Spirit. If you feel like a dry and weary land, allow God to come to you now and to pour out water on the thirsty soil. Be like the tree planted beside the flowing water that yields its fruit in due season. Tell God, like the psalmist, God, for you I long, for you my soul is thirsting. Soak in his love and drink deeply of his love as I read these scriptures to you. I am the living water. Come to the water, all who are thirsty. I shall pour out water on thirsty soil, and streams on the dry ground. I will guide them to streams of water. If anyone is thirsty, let them come to me. He who believes in me will never thirst. Near restful waters, he leads me to revive my drooping spirit. Whoever drinks this water will get thirsty again. But anyone who drinks the water that I shall give will never be thirsty again. The water that I shall give will turn into a spring inside him, welling up to eternal life. Amen.
So if you've been blessed by this teaching or any of the other teachings that we've given or the services that we've run, we'd really like to encourage you to like and share. If you like the videos, they get pushed up and sent out to more people. And if you want to kind of be in contact with us and see these teachings when they're coming up, we'd really encourage you to subscribe. If you press the subscribe button and then tap the bell button, you'll be reminded when these teachings are coming up, so you won't miss anything. So if you'd like to do that, that'd be really helpful. And we can get this grace of teaching that God's given us and the blessings that God's sharing with us out into a much wider body of people for their blessing and encouragement, their faith, and the building up of the church. God bless.